Felipe, thank you once again for taking the time today. I shared with you a moment ago, but I really did enjoy the film. Had an absolute, it was just an experience, and I was not expecting it. And it so far has been one of my favorites from the festival. But I have to ask, can you talk about the inspiration behind the writing of The Perfect David?
Yes, in some way, what you are saying, I like how you analyze the film, because it's like to get in a world, you know, like the world of the culturism and the world of David, that he's struggling with his mother, that the mother, Juana, the name of the mother in the
Yes.
movie, she's pushing him all the film to make like the perfect son, no? The idea came up because I have been always very interested in the topic of the dysfunctional families. I really like that topic, and one of my best friends, a writer, a script writer, Leandro Custo, is the co-writer of the film. He showed me a story about a mother and a son, and this thing with the body, and we start to work together for 3 or 4 years, rewriting or making the whole story.
Oh,
It was a very, very long long period, and without knowing when we could have the opportunity to shoot the film, you know?
sure.
And well, so I think that the film had like a combination between this real topic, no? The dysfunctional families, the relation about his mother and pushing him, no? Like, because it's something normal for a mother to pretend to have a perfect child.
Sure.
It's the normal, no? For everyone. Here, I think in the movie, it's like a metaphor of that. No, it's like a metaphor, and Juana doesn't have any filter at all to get the objective to have a perfect body. And I don't want to spoil, but
Yes.
to create an art piece, no, with her son. And I think that the originality of the film is that, no, because we are in the physical culturism world, but talking about the relationship about between a mother and a son,
Right.
because you know it's like that simplicity in a very complex context.
And there's some moments between mother and son that are a little unnerving when she's shaving his armpit or when she wipes his face at the restaurant. So that's definitely communicated that she's, you know, overstepping a little bit, and that control is very apparent.
And at the same time, those moments that you watch, those are the only moments where we can see Juana as a normal mom, you know, when she's with him in the coach. When she's at the in the bathroom with David, the rest of the film is like always.
Exactly. Can you, so the film really does focus mainly on two primary characters, and that being David and his mother. Can you speak about the phenomenal performances from Mauricio and Juana here? And this was Mauricio's first acting role, correct?
Yes, Mauricio, this is the debut of Mauricio. Mauricio is not an actor, but for me it was incredible how he could performance the main character, because the movies it's only a point of view, you know, but from David. So he's in every frame of the movie, in every frame. So for me, of course, and for my producers, it was something very, very important to find the correct character. And it's like a miracle that we found Mauricio, because he did a very subtle performance, you know?
He's absolutely
very subtle. And I think that I'm very mature for being a teenager of 18 years old, doing his first film and his first acting ever in his life. He's not that. So we did a coaching previously, 2 months before the shooting. We made a coaching with a casting director in Buenos Aires that help us to find David, and Umbra Colombo helped us a lot in that coaching too. And we told Mauricio the story more like if we were telling like a tale, you know, not like not like something like this is a script, you have to read it and you have to you know. We made a work more like to practice each scene together. Then we did a lot of rehearsals together with Umbra and Mauricio. I shoot all that rehearsals with my phone.
Oh wow.
And we did a lot of rehearsals with the other teenagers too, and David. All the most important scenes we rehearsed that for 1 month before the shooting.
It definitely comes across the maturity of Mauricio in this, especially because so much of the acting is done without dialogue.
Yeah.
There's a lot that is communicated just through emotion and body language. And I guess for you as a filmmaker, is that difficult to maintain the tone of a film when you're relying so much on body language?
It's a good question. No. I have been thinking in the tone of the film from the first day in the writing, because I pushed the script to have the correct tone, you know, to have a lock script and to go to shoot with the tone in the script. So when the actors read the script, they could understand the tone, you know? And during the shooting, the tone was totally locked, and I work every frame and every scene always thinking in the same tone, you know? How David's mother talk, how is the voice? Because we changed a little bit the tone of the voice of Umbra for the film. We practice a lot that, and I was always focused in have the same tone, you know, in the whole film. I like this kind of tone, no, at the same time. It's like I like the characters like a little bit cold characters, you know.
Sure. Yeah. And I have to say that, you know, the tone and the darkness of the film and the way in which The Perfect David is filmed in the shadows a lot, along with the score of the film, it really gives it a horror feel in a sense, even though it's not a horror film. It does give it a horror feel. Was that the intention?
I tried to make the viewer to feel that something is going to happen, you know, in every moment. And sometimes nothing happened. You know, it's like how it is the relationship between David and his mother, because they never tell each other nothing. They are always in silence, you know? And I have been trying to do that with the sound, with the music, with the color grading and the lighting, everything in the same direction, like generating that atmosphere, like you feel that now David is going to kill the mother. No, he's not going to do it. But you know what?
I did think that at one point.
Yeah, well, I really like I like that kind of narrative styles where you feel that something is coming, and because it's not because I wasn't searching for a suspense movie, eh?
Sure.
But yes, a sensorial, something sensorial about that, something wrong is happening here and nobody's talking about this. Like could happen in a family, you know?
Yeah.
Every family has a secret and nobody talk about that.
This is very true.
And I try in the film to get the viewer in that sensorial atmosphere, you know?
Yeah, definitely. And you know, it's funny too that some of David's friends in the film, and one in particular, is drawing reference to, you know, is your mom making money off of you? Or, you yeah. know, kind of knows a little bit about what's happening. And so it's kind of setting that up in what you're saying here. Like there's something going on and nobody's talking about it.
Exactly. So, and, sorry.
This is a little bit of a spoiler, but, you know, I'll warn people. But the film ends with David, you know, looking on as his fellow gym goer is competing in a bodybuilding competition. In your mind, what's next for David? You know, where does he go?
Now, in my mind, I think that David is trying to do something apart from his mom. That is the only moment of the film where he decides something for himself. Yeah. So he could, and if we analyze the whole film, the only real people for David are the culturist guys, because they treat him as one of them. Nobody of them is chatting David. And the other people surrounding him, they're really oppressive to him. The mother, the companions in the school. So if I have to think what is going to do David after the film, now I think that he's finding his own way, but it doesn't mean that he's going to be a culturist guy, you know? That activity could represent something that he's decided for himself. Yeah. That is, for me, is what he's going to start to decide what he wants to do, how to live, and everything is going to be okay for me, for him.
That's a great way to look at it. That's a very good way to look at it.
Yeah.
What do you hope that people take away from this film?
Well, I think that when we are in the adolescent moment in our lives, everyone is like waiting for us to decide what we have to do for the rest of our lives, which career we have to do, our oriental sexuality, our everything, how we are going to use the clothes, how are our friends, you know. And what I want to say with the film is that everything is going to be okay. No problem. You could have a lot of doubts when you are a teenager, even when you are a young adult too, and as an adult inclusive even. But I think that we can be ourselves, and at the end, everything could be okay, you know? That is what I want to transmit to the viewer, that specifically if we have a 18 years old viewer, for example, no, for the adults it's different, but for a 20s, I think that it's a moment very, very difficult in your life. You are trying to fit in a lot of places, and then when you're an adult, you discover that you continue doing that.
Absolutely.
You are going to continue doing that. So so I want to give to the viewer that sensation. I don't know if I am achieving that or not, you know, because the film is really dark, but I am trying to tell you could be in a very dark moment of your life, but little by little you are going to find the light.
It's such an important message, and I do think it comes through. Felipe, I mentioned earlier, but I found the film absolutely visually stunning and enthralling from start to finish. Congratulations on the achievement and the Tribeca premiere. And I thank you so much for taking the time to chat with me today about The Perfect David.
And thank you. Thank you for watching my film and to say all these beautiful things about my film. Absolutely. Thank you very much for your time and for everything.
Absolutely. Thank you so much.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.